Sean. Samira is one of the ace editors that she will be transferring those to.
Oh, okay.
She is a very
fan. Trying to be. I got halfway here and I don't
know. Hi.
That's
how are you?
See you.
Well,
another CNN.
Good to see
you. Hello, Ron. See you.
Yeah, we're doing good.
and Hollie Manheimer. I'm the director of the Chris Smith Foundation. And it starts in the week, actually, for those of you who have been coming for 15 years, it's the 15th annual. They're also a wealth of freedom of information award banquet. Pretty amazing to acknowledge that fact. Coupled with that fact, many of our sponsors are the same, and I think my job here is to thank all of you who support this great work that this great group, of course, I'm biased, does. The people that I want to work with, the people I want to acknowledge today, of course, are our platinum sponsors that are actually Stockton and CNN, our gold sponsors, the Atlanta Journal Constitution. It's hard to reflect every year on the successes and setbacks we've had in the First Amendment issues in Georgia and, of course, elsewhere. Many of you, like me, are on the front lines a lot. It's tough, but it's a fight that needs to be keep on keeping on. And everybody in this room, by being here, and I thank you for that, know that that's what we're doing. A couple of the other speakers this evening are going to address those issues, but again, I welcome you. I thank you for your support all this time. As you see First Amendment issues come up, email us, let us know so we can address them. And now, I want to turn my remarks over to my mentor, my dear friend, and someone who taught almost everything I know in connection with First Amendment, Hyde Post, who founded the Georgia First Amendment Foundation in 1994.
Good evening. I'm up here to introduce some of our guests, our distinguished guests tonight. We had to make a little schedule change, so we want to have people eat while I talk and not while other people who are more important talk. I want to introduce some of our distinguished guests we have with us. Former Weltner Award winner, Georgia Supreme Court Justice Carol Feinstein. We also have one of our foundation's former last year Open Government Hero Award winner, Nydia, Tisdale is here. Very honored, of course, to have former U.S. Senator Chris Dodd, our keynote speaker, and former U.S. Senator and former Congressman from Atlanta, Georgia, Wyche Fowler is here as well. We have Georgia Court of Appeals Judge Chris McFadden is here. Four members, not County Commissioner Lisa Cooper. And I would like to recognize, thank you, Steve, film industry, economic development, one of the leaders in Georgia, who's been working in the film industry, Georgia, Lee Thomas, who is the state department. As for me personally, and I think for the organization, it's always a great honor and pleasure to be named this award after Justice Charles Melton, who is a lifelong commitment to government transparency and open government. His served his public service is well known by everybody in this room. We've been very fortunate over the years to have members of the Weltner family here to make the award presentation. And Justice Weltner's daughter, Susan Weltner, now is here to make the presentation. Senator Dodd has seated with several members of the coalition and successfully advocated for the greatest legislative expansion of free speech rights in Georgia in the last 20 years. I can't That's what we're celebrating. And the Senator will talk about that in a few minutes. We've changed our schedule up a little bit. The book is it's a little different because of the program, put his speech a little early because he has to leave a little early. But we're happy to have you all here. Please enjoy your dinner, and we'll be back in a few minutes.
Speakers tonight, and so I'm going to ask Senator
Fowler and Tony Cruz for Dodd. Thank you very much.
Protection, in his case, of writers and directors and producers. producers and creative artists to tell their stories in all their diversity without censorship. We've got a man that we can rely on and that we continue to be proud of. You made a good choice in honoring you. Thank you very much.
Imagine this, if you can, your mind. So I'm walking up the back stairs at home, Ellsworth's home, the door opens up before I can knock on the door, and they're standing with Ellsworth, this guy I've never met, but I've seen a dozen times around. And neither one have their hearing aids in at this point, so they're speaking rather loudly. I'm only about a foot away. She's never even glanced in my direction, by the way. I'm the center at this point. And Ellsworth says to me in a very loud voice, "Would you like to meet Catherine Hepburn?" And she's a foot away. I'm honored to meet Miss Hepburn. He turns to Catherine. He says, "Catherine, would you like to meet Senator Dodd?" She never looks up, and a little head of her shaking. She said, "Why?" So tonight, I hope you're not saying the same thing. Anyway, I'm going to be with you and talk about the First Amendment and to talk about this wonderful industry that I've become the Chief Executive Officer of, and to receive on behalf of my remarkable staff, some of whom I'll introduce in a minute, at the Motion Picture Association, and for the work they do and many of you in this room have done. Recently, legislation, I stopped legislation, but other efforts you've made. So it truly is a pleasure to be here with you this evening. I thank you for all of that, if you can. I know you're, I honor the coalition's obviously two decades' work, as I understand it, long effort to advance the cause of open government and freedom of information. This year, each state was front and center, as you all know, in this room, on several very important First Amendment issues. Of course, it was the anti-SLAPP legislation. This bill signed by Governor Deal, who went about 2.5 hours still with this afternoon, I arrived in Georgia, and thanked him for his leadership on this issue, along with others in supporting this remarkable explosion of the film industry in this state. With a great interest, obviously, the creators of the motion picture and TV industry, as well as their colleagues and news organizations and related work, which is why we at the Motion Picture Association were pleased to stand shoulder to shoulder with all of you at the First Amendment Foundation in the struggle for free expression in this state and elsewhere. Every day, as all of you know, producers, writers, directors, as Wyche pointed out, and actors tell stories about other people. Sometimes the characters they bring to life are wholly fictional, as we all know. And sometimes those stories are based on real people, real events, including some people who prefer not to be talked about in a public setting. I think all of us can relate and understand that. But too frequently, legal actions are brought by those individuals, not to vindicate their rights, as they might suggest, but rather to silence creative people. With the passage of this new legislation in Georgia, our members' First Amendment rights can be vindicated quickly by a judge, not through years and years and years of burdensome litigation and hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars. We earned this legislative win, if you will, in Georgia together. And I want to recognize a number of the people who are here tonight, some who may not be, but recognize the people who are critical of the committee hearings on House Bill 513. Peter Canfield, Parker Jones Day, Atlanta, and a national leader among media litigators, served as one of the anti-SLAPP coalition's lead witnesses and did an outstanding job. Other strong advocates for our cause included Cynthia Counts, Margaret Duane Morris, Tom Clyde, Margaret Kilpatrick Townsend, as well as his colleague Leslie Gayton. And of course, Harold has been with the Motion Picture Association now for about a few years. I'm not going to go back. Jack Delaney and he would be great school together. I didn't meet him. A long time working together at the Motion Picture Association. He was one of our strongest advocates in the motion picture industry here in Georgia. Tell me, thank you for your leadership as well. Television production that this state now enjoys so much. Michael Wall is here this evening. Michael, thank you. You're from Comcast. Carolyn Forrest from 20th Century Fox as well. Carolyn, thank you for your contribution. And finally, I want to acknowledge the work of one of our own, the MPAA, Ben Shepard. Ben is here tonight and he logged, I don't know how many miles between LAX, where he operates out of in our office, between there and Atlanta early this year to help get this bill over the finish line. And Ben, I thank you immensely. And many ways you are responsible for standing up here and receiving this award for the work that you've done. My good friend Dan Stevenson, who's been with the MPAA for years, great friend of Tom's as well, who joined us tonight, but also deserves a great deal of credit for the work he did in organizing our efforts on this behalf. And So it was there, Angela, immediately. Angela, where are you? You're right here in front. So thank you, Nancy, for your work as well. The men and women in this room, of course, others who are deeply involved, all part of the sacrament and work together. And when necessary, we have stood up to those when they attempt to intimidate or silence the work of others. One half a century ago, a Georgia convict, Charles Weltner, Susan's here, and I had the pleasure of meeting earlier. We're not moving around. We're right now, some neighbor, Susan over here. Stood up, courageously stood up against those who sought to deny African Americans' voice. Congressman Weltner was the only member of the congressional delegation from Georgia in 1964 to vote for the Civil Rights Act legislation. In 1966, as many of you in this room know, we designed a time to run for Congress because the Democratic Party in those days demanded to sign a loyalty oath to support Lester Maddox, and he could not do that, good conscience. And so he resigned to seat in the United States Congress. We might mention what politics have been like today. Regardless of whether I agree with Tom or Charles Weltner or not, wouldn't it be refreshing to have those kind of voices representing all our interests in the halls of legislative bodies all over the time? So it's an honor to receive this recognition on behalf of the Motion Picture Association. But in addition to being honored, it's humbling to all of the MPAA to be receiving an award associated with this remarkable, patriotic American, your father. And so if he's listening here right now, we appreciate immensely his leadership and what he courage he showed in those days. As CEO of the Motion Picture Association, I mentioned Ben already, but like all of you in this room, we all either work with other people or our organizations, and it's the people around us who make such a difference. And I have a wonderful staff in the United States Congress for many years. I'd like to refer to some pieces of legislation about remarkable people who work with us. And today I'm blessed to have remarkable people from the Motion Picture Association who do an incredible job, not only on behalf of the industry, but on behalf of the person that and I'm pleased to have you on the show working with them. So on behalf of all of our staff, then, I thank you for the great work of all of you. And as I said earlier, you should have many of you receiving this award today on behalf of the MPA as well. And it's Thomas Buckner's part of the influence that shaped the views of others from the First Amendment champions already mentioned, to obviously, Wyche was his chief of staff in 65 and 66, made a huge difference. In many ways, I think Congressman Weltner sort of began that notion of making a difference in the New South in many ways. And I mentioned to Governor Deal today, when April Deal of Georgia's so-called Religious Liberty Bill, which is, well, I believe Charles Weltner was responsible for sort of giving birth to a generation of political leadership in the state who wanted to stand up and as Nathan Deal did. We do not share the same political affiliation, but I admire him immensely for his courage to stand up in the wake of a very popular movement in a different direction. Now, when it comes to the First Amendment, of course, the Motion Picture Association has a lot at stake in Georgia. I'd be remiss if I didn't tell you how much we appreciate what's occurring in this state, home of one of the most robust and vibrant creative communities in the world, along the United States. The list of television and production credits, the movie film credits in Georgia is tremendously impressive. According to the Georgia Democratic Department of Economic Development, some 245 feature films and television productions have been shot in Georgia in fiscal year 2016, representing $2.2 billion in direct spending in the state and an overall economic impact of $7 billion in the state as well. Capital in Georgia is number three in film and television production in the United States after California and New York. Fantastic creative product is being made here every day. Tom Hanks' new film, Sully, Ben Affleck's new picture, The Accountant, both were filmed here in Georgia, as is one of the most watched TV shows in the world, AMC's The Walking Dead, which I've never seen, that's why I said that. Broadcast. As well as in 125 global territories around the globe. Motion picture and television production account for 25,000 jobs in this state, direct jobs generating $1.7 billion in wages. This work, of course, must be supported, which is why we're such enthusiastic supporters of the efforts to strengthen Georgia's existing anti-SLAPP law, discouraging plaintiffs from filing groundless defamation lawsuits, and other claims designed to chill free speech in Georgia. It's not only good for screenwriters, directors, and producers, but for everyone in this state and elsewhere. That includes everyone in our industry, our friends in the news media, and local citizens who should not have to fear the threat of a ruinous lawsuit for speaking out at a local city council or zoning board meeting as well. I have been passionate about the First Amendment throughout my adult life, and particularly my years in the United States Senate. As a senator, long during the 1980s, when our government was engaged in a secret deal making with Iran, in the Nicaraguan Contras, a group with atrocious human rights record, I spoke out as several of my other colleagues did as well. And I was proud that Democrats and Republicans were willing to demand that there be a greater accountability, including the press in those days, casting a harsh and a proper spotlight on those activities, which had to be apologized for by the administration in those days. In more recent years, in the aftermath of the 9/11 attacks on our country, we overreacted to the unprecedented threats to our freedoms, the freedom of expression, the rule of law, and in some misguided effort to fight terrorism. Some of you may recall that we went to war in Afghanistan. Journalists who relied on confidential sources were harassed and intimidated by the government into silence and retreat. A small bipartisan group of those of us in Congress responded by sponsoring the Free Flow of Information Act, which was designed to protect journalists and confidential sources from the threat of being hauled into court or, worse, being jailed, as several were. In 2006, my friend and former colleague, the conservative Republican senator from Utah, Bob Bennett, who recently passed away, courageously fought a proposed constitutional amendment to ban flag desecration. By the narrowest margin, we were able to defeat that proposal. By one single vote, the vote of this courageous conservative Republican from Utah, did not really save some obnoxious flag desecrators from prosecution, but rather, far more importantly, he helped preserve the integrity of the First Amendment. And there are cases you can go on all evening talking about people like Charles Butler, who stood up at critical moments and made a difference to protect the basic fundamental right which guarantees us every other right we have, the First Amendment. So when I left the United States Congress and became the chairman and CEO of the Motion Picture Association of America, I gained a newfound appreciation, if you will, for the film and television industry's nearly 100 years of First Amendment advocacy. I was able to continue my passion for advocating these rights, the right to create, to tell stories without fear of retribution, the right to be heard. Being an advocate of the First Amendment, the audiovisual world does not mean you agree with what you're hearing, the support what you're seeing. What it does mean, as all of you appreciate in this room, is that you are willing to fight for the right of those voices to be heard and seen. And powerful stories need, in fact, to be shared and seen and heard. Our best films and television shows often say what urgently needs to be said, even if what they have to say offends some. As an art form, the movies, as well as top television productions, have the power to change people's minds and even people's lives. Over the decades, Hollywood has tackled some of the loftiest concepts expressed in our founding documents, dramatizing them and making them resonant for millions, not only here, but around the world as well. And while I could cite, as I'm sure many of you could hear, numerous examples of the contributions film and television shows have made to civic life, consider, if you will, just a few of these. In 1940, Charlie Chaplin created cinema's first important political satire when he mocked Adolf Hitler in The Great Dictator. 2 years after World War II ended, Gregory Peck starred in A Gentleman's Agreement, one of the first films to tackle the subject of anti-Semitism. Pawnbroker tackled the subject again in 1960, as did Schindler's List in the 1990s. Gregory Peck's Atticus Finch, To Kill a Mockingbird, told a simple but profound story of one man's courageous fight against racial discrimination in a small southern town. In the same way that TV shows like Roots and films like Guess Who's Coming to Dinner broke new ground in race relations, Philadelphia and Boys Don't Cry opened up discussion about sexual identity and human rights. Films also remind us that a healthy skepticism of political and corporate authority sometimes is deeply warranted. The 1970 thriller, 3 Days for the Congo, or Russell Crowe's portrayal of a tobacco industry whistleblower, the inscriber,
all grow that message home. And motion pictures also can remind us of the vital role of a free press and a democracy. All the President's Men and Spotlight, last year's Academy Award winning Best Picture, about the investigative reporters at the Boston Globe who exposed child abuse in the Catholic Church in Boston, are memorable examples of the power of film. Concussion challenged the National Football League and the Big Short financial institutions. Whether it's confronting tyrants abroad, or speaking truth to power at home, or pursuing the limits and buttons of our society's tolerance and cultural understanding, motion pictures and television often dare to say the unspeakable, which is why, since our founding in 1922, the Motion Picture Association has fought for the First Amendment rights not only our movie makers, but our movie-going audience as well. In the 1930s, we created the Motion Picture Production Code, which allowed Hollywood writers, directors, and producers to create and manage their own content rather than have the government dictate what can and cannot be shown on screen, as is the case today in many countries around the world. Another crucial fight over the value of the First Amendment rights occurred in the 1950s, when the U.S. Supreme Court held for the first time, Tory White just mentioned here in the Wilson case, that motion pictures are fully protected by the First Amendment. And in 1968, my predecessor, Jack Valenti, replaced the so-called Hayes Code with a voluntary rating system aimed at giving parents the information they might need to decide whether a film is appropriate for their children and their families. Once again, keeping government out of the business of censoring which movies people should or should not see. More recently, we prevailed again in Sarver versus the Hurt Locker, one of the more important cases to address the First Amendment rights of filmmakers in years. Many of you may know the backstory of this movie and this case. In fact, I use the word backstory as a Hollywood term, but I don't know. But the backstory, in early March of 2010, U.S. Army bomb disposal expert Master Sergeant Jeffrey Sarver filed a multi-million dollar lawsuit against a number of companies and people who created the Oscar-winning movie, The Hurt Locker. By the way, that was the first movie where a woman was given the Oscar for her directorship, Catherine Bigelow, who did a remarkable job. In fact, a great side story on that one is that year she was competing against Avatar. And the director of that was James Cameron, her former husband. And Catherine Bigelow won the Oscar and beat her husband. Not a bad thing, we're talking these days about the rights of women, by the way. Did a great job. But obviously, she was being sued, as long as the companies that produced the film. Sergeant Saunders also claimed that the filmmakers had violated his right of publicity, that publicity based on the film's main character on him without his permission. The filmmakers argued that they had a First Amendment right to make a movie based on real people and real events without permission from their subjects. Such movies have long been the staple of Hollywood, from Citizen Kane, Primary Colors, and The Social Network, just to cite three examples of where that has been the case. The MPAA filed an amicus brief in the U.S. Court of Appeals, the Ninth Circuit, in that case, warning the court of the chilling effect a ruling in favor of Sergeant Asaro would have the ability to make films based on true characters and true circumstances. Earlier this year, the Ninth Circuit held for the defendants in that case, and indeed all filmmakers in this country. The Hurt Locker, that court ruled, and I quote from it, is speech that is fully protected by the First Amendment, which safeguards the storytellers and artists who take the raw materials of life, including the stories of real individuals, ordinary or extraordinary, and transform them into art, be it articles, books, movies, or plays, end of quote. Of course, the Ninth Circuit's Hurt Locker case won't put an end to lawsuits about fact-based movies, but it's a major step in the right direction. That said, I'm also optimistic that will bolster filmmakers' right to draw on raw materials of life to tell critically important stories, not merely for their entertainment value, but because they are evocative, they educate, and they urge us on to think differently about all causes and issues that we should. At the Motion Picture Association, we believe we have a duty to protect creative speech. We also believe we have a duty to protect the integrity of their right to earn a living doing it. And as many of you may know, there are efforts underway both here all around the world need to weaken copyright and IP protections. Across the globe, you will find no greater advocate for and defender of free expression, that the men and women of the television and motion picture industry. But it is critical that lawmakers and the public not confuse a free and open internet with working for free. Copyright is the means by which the marketplace for cultural, educational, scientific works can be created, including books, newspapers, magazines, software, music, film, television, and the list goes on. Indeed, that is why the Supreme Court again referred to copyright as the engine of free expression. I believe firmly that without protection of copyright, many of the creators who authors of these works would be silenced. We in the audiovisual industry ask that you help in these efforts as well, not merely because it is right and a fair thing to do, but because all Americans have a strong stake in protecting the intellectual property of these creators. Creative people must have that right, if they choose, to be compensated for the use and enjoyment of their creations. But if the bulk of creative people's work, product is stolen or shared, it says, it is euphemistically called today, there is less to invest in future movie and TV productions and other creative enterprises. As I noted at the outset of these remarks, 25,000 people who work directly in Georgia's motion picture industry and television sector will be heavily impacted by the client support of copyright. Now, the good news is that Georgia has many people fighting for the First Amendment, as well as for strong copyright. Two issues that are absolutely essential and linked, I would argue, to the success of the movie and television industry here and elsewhere. In closing, let me tell you a quick story about a gentleman I met a few years ago at a film festival in Australia. The fellow and I got to chatting. Soon became evident he was more than just a critic of cinema. He has rather profound and negative things to say about the United States, about foreign policy, highly critical of one thing after another that we did. Rather getting bored of listening to quite a lot, we stopped after about 10 minutes of going out and listening to the litany of everything that we did wrong in this country. And he said, but I must tell you, you do something that very few other countries do. He said, you allow your film and television industry to attack every public, private, nonprofit institution in your country. And at the end of it, you give them little gold statues and awards for doing so. No one else in the world does anything quite like this. There are a few places. And it truly is a better compliment than I say about what you're achieving here in Georgia with this foundation. What we try to achieve in this industry every day with all the challenges it faces and the difficulty of putting these products together, the jobs that we create in this state and elsewhere, and making a difference in people's lives. So I'm deeply again honored to receive on behalf of the MPAA the Charles Weltner Award from the First Amendment Foundation here in Georgia. Please keep up the wonderful work you're doing. And as long as we're in business, in the motion picture business, we'll keep fighting for the First Amendment. We've got our word on that. Thank you.
But I want to say we've had some bad news on the First Amendment lately in Georgia.
had a tough year. Planning County Journalist Mark Thompson was here, was jailed for a segment. He made an open record request. And thankfully, that indictment has been dismissed. We'll talk a little bit more about that. Made my legislative move to change the time limit on some the amount of time some government agencies have to respond to open records requests, specifically government agencies that have to do with football teams, and change the time period from 3 days to 90 days, which is makes the law meaningless. We've had court rulings that threaten to erode transparency of publicly owned hospitals. And court rulings that will establish new loopholes for the 2012 rewrite of the state government laws that was led by Attorney General Sam Owens. And of course, our own open government bureau from last year, Nydia, Tisdale, is facing felony charges of obstructing an officer when she was arrested for filming a public political rally. This is not good. These are the reasons your First Amendment Foundation exists. We fight for government transparency and freedom of speech every day. We're the only organization in Georgia that does that sole mission specifically. Let me quickly remind you a little bit of what we do. We monitor legislation and regulations that would harm government and transparency. That means Hollie spends a lot of time at the Capitol educating lawmakers about access to public meetings and public records, and the need to keep both open. We spend time in courtrooms, objecting to sealed cases, courtroom closures. We also fight for court proceedings to remain open and transparent, and we file briefs on key litigation that could affect access to government records and government meetings. We surveil the landscape and keep you aware of things that are going on that you need to know about as First Amendment advocates. And we're part of a national coalition of organizations like the Georgia First Amendment Foundation that does this work, so we share and support them and they support us. I was with that coalition last week and we were talking some about the kind of threats that we're watching for. So let me tell you a little bit about what we're watching in the next year. The General Assembly has repeatedly passed legislation that would expand the secrecy around the state's negotiations to bring new companies to Georgia, and we believe that citizens in communities have a right to know. For instance, if a factory or a prison or a company is going to be built in their community before the deal is finalized, so we fight for that and advocate for citizens' right to know about potential new businesses in their community. Police are spending tax dollars on body cameras. The whole point of that is supposed to be to improve accountability of the police and transparency of police. But some agencies are claiming that it's their right to indefinitely seal the video because of pending investigation. And we have people in Georgia who claim that if there is, for instance, a controversial shooting by police, that it would be prejudicial to release that video before a trial, which might be years after the event. So we're working very hard to make sure body cameras bring more accountability to police. The prison reform movement in Georgia has done a lot of good things, and one of the things that it's done that is challenging for us, but understandable, is help people who have been convicted of a crime restore their records. We have erasure statutes in Georgia that help people restore their record, get their criminal past basically deleted from public view. And we want to make sure that those statutes don't go too far and when Georgia businesses and citizens at risk of hiring employees who have been found guilty of serious crimes, most of them will not know that. The General Assembly, as I said, is delaying public and press access to records related to Georgia college sports. We believe the public has a right to see for themselves what contracts are signed, what misconduct has occurred, what actions have been taken. And we will support efforts to repeal that 90-day law because such a long delay makes the right to these records meaningless. And as I said, Georgia courts have recently issued rulings that erode transparency of public hospitals, law enforcement, other institutions. Georgia First Amendment Foundation and our partners have taken action in the courts to oppose those that erosion of public access, and we'll continue to work on that. The digitization of public information is causing new challenges. Many of the government agencies want to outsource their records to digital experts, contractors who do work, and we have to work hard to make sure that when the government outsources its work, it doesn't outsource citizens' rights to transparency. Without vigilance by the First Amendment Foundation, these fingers will drive up the cost of public records, try to charge commercial rates, make a profit off of information that the citizens and taxpayers of Georgia have already paid to be compiled. So we're working on that. And then one of the new areas that we're looking into is this concern. We have great concern that language on Georgia ballots has become increasingly misleading. The constitutional amendments, someone was telling me tonight that that pretty much saved us from motherhood and apple pie, and we would oppose them. And we need the transparency. We need transparency on the language on the ballots so that the citizens know what they're voting on. And we're going to be really tracking that trend and working on that. We know that we don't know all the issues that we'll need to track in the coming year, but we will be on the case. And the reason I want to tell you that is because our ability to act on those issues is supported by you at this banquet and in participating in the First Amendment Foundation. We encourage you, we've switched over the last year to become a membership organization. We encourage you to become a member. You can join on our website, it's easy to do, and to stay in touch with us through our newsletter and our legislative alerts, to attend events like these, and to join with other like-minded First Amendment champions to rally for the First Amendment and government transparency that is so important to Georgia. So again, I want to thank you for your support tonight. You allow us to do